by majority respectively of each of the two groups of members, I declare the motion as amended passed.
無立法效力.
Debate on motion with no legislative effect. Motion on creating opportunities to assist small and medium enterprises and promoting upward mobility of young people. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button. I now call upon Mr. Tony Chair to speak and move the motion. Mr. President, I move that the motion as printed on the agenda be passed. Mr. President, Hong Kong is a highly advanced economy. In many sectors, we have many major corporations, enterprises with a vast pool of talents, financial resources and capital, and we also have multinational groups. To a certain extent, this is a good thing. From another perspective, however, some members of the public are also concerned that whether Hong Kong economy or certain sectors of our economy have been monopolized by major corporations and conglomerates. Shorten Central Link scandal happened earlier demonstrates that for many infrastructure projects in Hong Kong, the consultancy and construction projects contracts are always taken up by the few major enterprises. Even for multinational corporations, their works may not be guaranteed as far as quality is concerned. We have a lot of red tape, and our system and our procedures are getting too rigid. This may hinder the development of innovation and technology in the creative industries, not to mention the slow economic growth in recent years with towering property prices and rental. Many small and medium enterprises with less human capital and financial capital to enter the market and sustain its development. Over the past 2 years, I have got in touch with the SMEs and young professionals in my sector and outside my sector. Although the government in recent years has introduced a number of measures to promote different developments and set up funds and training schemes to help SMEs and young people, but time and time again, I have been told that there aren't many opportunities for them to develop in Hong Kong. The upward mobility is getting less and less frequent. They question whether the government could really help them. That is why the first member's motion I moved in this term of the Legislative Council is to urge the administration to create opportunities to help promote upward mobility of young people and to help SMEs. As the policy address puts it, to rekindle their hope and to facilitate their participation in the development and construction of Hong Kong. I have six specific proposals in my motion, Mr. President. First of all, we need to reform the procurement and tendering systems of the government and public organizations. We need to attach more importance to creative designs and innovative technology in evaluation, rather than putting emphasis on the lowest bid wins principle. I understand the government has conducted a review of this matter, and there is a plan that the new procurement system will be put in place in April this year. I hope that this reform will be in line with my proposal. But as I understand, the new system will only apply to service contracts of the government and some works projects. But I think that the system should be expanded to cover the MTRCL, Housing Authority and Airport Authority, etc., which are statutory organizations. But even if we have a new system, when it comes to implementation, we may not follow what is in the books. According to members of the industry, when they bid for construction projects, whenever they propose new construction technology or materials to the government, the civil servant responsible for vetting will ask, has it been tried in any other project? Has it been tried out in any other country? But if there is always precedent for everything, if this has been done by anyone before, if this is a prerequisite, why? How will we have innovation and creativity in terms of the experience, qualification, and capital requirement of tenderers? The government always sets an unnecessarily high threshold. This may undermine the opportunity for SMEs and young professionals with fewer experience and with operations of a smaller scale to participate in the process. Of course, for highly complex infrastructure projects, the government should engage experienced companies. For medium or small to medium-sized projects which do not involve complex technology, do we still require the company to have a vast capital and vast experience? Sometimes there is the government also takes into account how many government contracts you have done before. So for startups and for young professionals who have never taken on board any government contracts, that means they have no opportunity. And we should also split up larger contracts so that they don't have to be bundled together. For minor works projects, repair and maintenance projects, and smaller scale projects, they will be done in all 18 districts, but there is no need for them to bundle up into one single contract for tendering. We can consider splitting up into a few districts each. Of course, when we have one single contract, it's easier for the government to manage. But then, this would deprive the opportunities of SMEs to participate. And at the end of the day, the contracts will still go to large companies. The design will just be carbon copies of one another and devoid of characteristics. And then we should also help young people and SMEs to develop markets and seize the opportunities presented by the Greater Bay Area, including setting up more offices in the GBA to provide more support to local SMEs and young people. I've already talked about this in my speech in the vote of thanks to the policy address. By setting up the steering committee for the development of the GBA and appointing a commissioner for the GBA development is not sufficient. We have Guangdong office and a liaison office in Shenzhen, and these two cities are our closest trade and economic partners, but they are also our keenest competitors. There are seven other cities in the Guangdong province and not as developed. There is more room and potential for development there. So the government should at least set up one or two offices in a couple of the cities there to tap into their markets so that we can provide direct support to Hong Kong people minded to set up their business or to find work or to stay there for study. And the third proposal is to hold architectural design competitions, and the winners should be allowed to participate in the projects. And for unsuccessful entrants whose works have reached a certain standard, they should be provided with reasonable design fees as encouragement. A design entrant with innovation and a tender with quality require manpower resources. Even though it may be a small project, the preparation cost may be a little less than $100,000. This won't be a problem for large companies because they have the resources. But for SMEs and young people, if they fail once and twice, maybe they don't have the financial capability to take part in the third competition. For the Kai Tak Sports Complex, this was adopted, and we did the same for the design competition for WKCD. For successful entrants or participants, although they failed to get the contract, they were given some design fees. However, these two projects were mega projects and they had nothing to do with SMEs. I propose the same approach for small and medium-sized works so as to support SMEs and young professionals. Even though they do not win in a particular competition, they should be given some incentive so that they can be encouraged to continue to take part and accumulate experience. For example, the children's playground operated by the LCSD, they are often criticized as being very mundane, and they do not provide enough fun.
Perhaps we can have a design competition for such playgrounds as well. We can also hold design competition for pavilions and also rain shelters and leisure facilities of our country park. And then we can come up with design with real characteristics. And as for the continuing education fund, we should raise the ceiling of subsidy and also the scope of subvention. The government has raised the ceiling from $10,000 to $20,000. I welcome that, but this is not good enough. In my election campaign, I proposed that it be increased to $50,000 because the continuing education expenses are quite unaffordable to some of the young professionals. And as for supporting employees to engage in continuous education, I suggest that we provide staff training allowance to some enterprises. Many SMEs would want to enhance staff training, but then because the scale of the operation is limited, and if one is on study leave or locally overseas, that will be a major impact on the government's operation. A staff training allowance may not be the ultimate solution, but at least that is an incentive for employers to encourage their workers to engage in training. And the fifth part is to help young people with aspirations for starting their own business because rentals in Hong Kong are very high, and young people cannot afford a high rental, and accommodation accounts for the largest share of the operating expenses. Not long ago, I visited Hangzhou, and the government there provide a lot of support for university graduates from other provinces. I understand that our science park has a similar system, but we only support those in science and technology, and the threshold is very high, and then the premises there may not be available to startups and ordinary young people. In Hong Kong, we have some universities providing similar support to outstanding graduates. Yes, we lack resources and land, but if the government has the will, there is always a way to do it. For instance, we have idle government buildings and government schools. Now, if we want to convert them to residential accommodation, that may be different. But if we turn them into shared office space, it is much simpler. Lastly, we should have a home ownership ladder with clearly defined levels to assist young people. Although property prices have dropped a little bit, still they are out of reach of the ordinary affordability of our people. Although we have more types of subsidized housing, but they are oversubscribed. It is so difficult. It is harder to buy an HOS flat than winning a lottery. And as a result, young people do not have the incentive to move up the housing ladder and the social ladder. Recently, I have asked an oral question, it's just yesterday, on helping people to get a higher chance of buying subsidized housing. In fact, I have proposed a number of measures to enhance the current system. For instance, we should upward adjust the ratio for white form application of HOS, or we should have subsidized housing only open to white form applicants. We can start sandwich class housing, and we can also raise the income level of first-time home buyers and the asset level. And we can also have a repurchase mechanism for different kinds of subsidized housing, so on and so forth. Well, nowadays, people rely on their parents in order to buy their first homes. Now, they may be able to afford high monthly mortgage, but if they do not have support from their parents, they may not be able to afford the high down payment, or they may have to go to money lenders, or they can only buy in the first-hand market. which can pay part of the down payment for them. But there may be other social problems arising from that. So can't the government give them a hand? It is the government is of the view that it is premature to remove the harsh measures for dampening the property market, and it cannot relax the down payment requirement. In my recent meeting with the FSI, I asked whether we can subsidize the insurance levy for first-time home purchasers so that they can pay less down payment. With these remarks, I beg to move.
I now propose the question to you that the motion moved by Honourable Tony Che be passed. Seven members will move amendments to this motion. This council will conduct a joint debate on the motion and the amendments. I'll call upon members who will move the amendments to speak in the following order. Honourable WU Chi-wai, Dr. Honourable Lo Wai-kwok, Dr. Honourable Charles Peter MOK, Dr. KK Kwok, Mr. LUK Chung-hung, Honourable Paul Chair, Honourable Dr. N. Jen, but they may not move the amendments at this stage. Honourable WU Chi-wai. Mr. President, well, Mr. Tony Chair has moved this motion, creating opportunities to assist small and medium enterprises and promoting upward mobility of young people. For items 1, 3, and 4, I think they are quite substantive. I would like to add a few more items to his motion, from 7 to 10 in my amendment. But then there are two points in his motion that are related to the macro environment, and I would like to have a discussion here. On different occasions, we have talked about the opportunities offered by the Greater Bay Area. Well, for the Greater Bay Area, it is a concept, it is a policy devised by the mainland government. Of course, it is going to have an impact on our future economic development in Hong Kong. So it is both an opportunity, it may also become a crisis. This is because we need to understand fully and clearly the possible impacts on our future economic development. Well, last time we went to the Greater Bay Area and we could see for ourselves the adverse impact on us. There are 9 cities in the mainland, and in fact, they are all trying to compete for talents in order to develop innovation and technology industries, and they spare no efforts and they spare no money in getting the right talents. For Guangzhou, in order to allow the Hong Kong UST to establish a campus in Guangzhou, they're going to provide different kinds of incentives like subsidies. In other words, when the mainland cities consider the future of the Greater Bay Area, they understand what is critical, and they know that they have to get the talents, and then they would tell whether it is going to help them to win or they will lose. When we talk about the Greater Bay Area, I think this is the crux of the matter. In other words, there are different cities in the Greater Bay Area trying to set their eyes on fighting for sufficient talents. Now, for the Hong Kong government, the pro-establishment camp here, as well as the public at large, I think other than joining in the race for talents, there isn't anything else that we can fall upon. If we don't get the talents to stay in Hong Kong, to come to Hong Kong, then in fact we're losing our talents to the Greater Bay Area. In the past, we were able to see for ourselves the change when the mainland government opened up 30% of our GDP in the form of the manufacturing industries were all moved northwards. Well, for 20, 30 years thereafter, we benefited from economic prosperity. Economic transformation is an important idea. When we see that there are new policies in our neighboring cities, we have to check the possible impacts on us. So we have to understand the crisis that may result, and then through this exercise, we should try to identify the possible opportunities. Now, for Mr. Tony Chen's motion, as well as the other amendments, I'm afraid they are still encouraging the young people to go north to seek opportunities. Well, to follow this logic, it means that we want to get better tax incentives, or there should be more platforms for young people to set up their businesses on the mainland. But what about the positioning of our own economic development? We are still unclear, and yet we likely resort to encouraging our people, especially our young people, to go north to grab opportunities, telling them that they have more opportunities there. I'm afraid, as far as our human capital is concerned, I'm afraid we are being hollowed out. In other words, this will become worrying for us. For the same batch of lawmakers, they always say that we need to diversify our economic development. We need to enhance the percentage taken up by R&D in our GDP. But then for talents, if they don't identify opportunities in Hong Kong, they won't stay, they won't come, and it will break or make Hong Kong. Of course, for those who are capable, for those who are elites, I don't object to them going north to look for opportunities. I do respect their freedom of choice, and it is a matter of life planning for them. But then for the Hong Kong government, on the contrary, I think we need to exploit the potentials of our economic development. We need to find ways to keep our talents and to attract overseas talents. Now, when foreigners come to Hong Kong, when outsiders come to Hong Kong, we need to convince them that it's worth their while to stay here. If they are engaged in R&D, they want to know that there is a critical mass, there is a cluster of like-minded people. Therefore, in my amendment, I am saying that we should make good use of the R&D teams in our tertiary institutions, and we have the Lok Ma Chau loop. We should be clear about the positioning. We want to set up a super scientific research center. If we don't do that, please imagine whether we are able to compete for people with Guangzhou. We have already got some scholars, researchers moving north. If they don't see any further opportunities in Hong Kong, then they will easily take away their teams from Hong Kong. Now, you can imagine that if there are opportunities on the mainland, the local governments would certainly try to attract talents from all over the world to go there. Therefore, for us in Hong Kong, we need to make sure that we have got opportunities here. Let me cite an example in relation to the medical services industry. Now, in Hong Kong, we have already built up a brand name. That is, we provide quality, high standard, reliable medical services. But then we need two points. First of all, hardware. Second, software. We need to have sufficient facilities, equipment, and talents. And they can only, they have to stay in Hong Kong before we can maintain our reputation. But if we encourage off-site hospitals so that our Hong Kong doctors and professionals are sent north to carry out the operations there, then I just doubt if we can still keep our reputation. It is worrying. Therefore, I want to share with you my ideas about the strategy. You have to be clear about the development of the Greater Bay Area. We have to take it seriously, think carefully about it, and then we know how to cope with it. Now, in the race for human talents, I don't think we can afford to drag our feet. We have to move faster. We have to make sure that we keep the talents in Hong Kong. And then for the motion as well as the amendments, it is said that for the sake of our competitiveness, we need to make sure that there is a housing ladder, in particular, affordability. But is it really going to go hand in hand with entrepreneurship of our young people. Now, if the property prices for residential homes are expensive, it means that we are trying to bundle our future with our position on the housing ladder. And this way, I'm sure it is going to stifle their creativity and their aspiration to be to move outwards socially. So I don't think you should emphasize home ownership and think that this is the only solution. Rather, we should diversify the options available. But of course, we should emphasize accommodation needs rather than home ownership. If they have a roof over their heads, then they have the room for creativity. Of course, there is a lot of bureaucracy. It is duty bound on the part of the government to deregulate and remove the hurdles. I think the government should make sure that we remove the unnecessary obstacles. Otherwise, creativity will be limited by bureaucracy. So I would like to share with you my views. Your time is up. Please stop.
DJ.
Dr. Lo Wai-kwok. Thank you. President, Mr. Tong Lee's motion urges the administration to assist SMEs and promote upward mobility of young people. I believe that has the support of most members here. My motion adds to the original motion on specific measures and policies. President, the global economic outlook is full of uncertainties. IMF has just downward adjust the global economic growth to 3.5% in 2019, the lowest in the last 3 years. That shows we have a likely downward trend in our economic development. And then there will also be new opportunities brought about by GBA to face these challenges and grasp the opportunities. We must make good use of our fiscal surplus so that we can have targeted measures and policies to consolidate existing advantages and enhance competitiveness and further promote diversified and regional economic development. We have 330,000 SMEs in Hong Kong, accounting for over 98% of the enterprises in Hong Kong. Assisting SMEs will help to stabilize our economy and employment. Now, to assist SMEs, there are two main things. First, we should remove the restrictions as soon as possible. I have proposed to the CE a number of times that we should improve our tendering systems, and we should promote a system that can assist green and energy saving and industries. We should also reform our tendering systems. When necessary, our contracts should be breaking up into different contracts so that SMEs can have a fair chance. I'm happy to see that in 2018, the policy address proposed that in April this year, there will be a new government procurement policies. In assessing tenders, the ratio of technology will be adjusted upwards so that innovative tenders will stand a higher chance of success. And the OGCIO will also set up a new office for smart and innovation development. People will be encouraged to submit proposals on innovation technology application and products. This will create more business opportunities for SMEs and startups. Last year, in last April, together with Mr. Tong Lee, we wrote to the country's relevant authorities asking for some of the restrictions for Hong Kong companies to take part in contracts or construction projects in the mainland to be waived. We've received a positive response, and we will do that under CEPA, and the waiving of restrictions will be done in an orderly manner. I urged the CE to follow up closely with the relevant mainland ministries to amend the provisions of CEPA framework so as to expand the coverage of mutual recognition of professional qualifications and credentials between Hong Kong and mainland, relax the restriction on Hong Kong construction and engineering enterprises participating in mainland's engineering construction, and encourage enterprises of the two places to jointly tender for large-scale national and multinational projects, with a view to enabling local young talents of various professions and SMEs to gain more experience and grasp more opportunities. Another policy to assist SMEs is to encourage investment in R&D. Myself and BPA have proposed to the SL government to improve the vetting mechanism for various R&D schemes. We should expand the coverage of the R&D cash rebate scheme, and we should extend the arrangement of double or triple tax deduction for R&D expenditures to cover areas such as environmental protection and design, thereby strengthening the support for SMEs in creative and green production. The relevant authorities should capitalize on the development trend of e-commerce and develop internet economy, supporting the industry to establish a cross-boundary e-commerce platform and perfect areas such as cross-boundary electronic payment, logistics, and after-sales services so as to assist SMEs and young entrepreneurs to develop and operate online businesses and increase the external sales of products. As regards promoting upward mobility of our young people, I think we should focus on three things, their education, career, and home ownership, so that there can be upward mobility for our young people. When it comes to education, the SLG should promote a diversified model of talent nurturing and training and enhanced career development and planning, and there should be a survey of manpower demand in SMEs and in the middle-ranking employees, and there should be more resources so that vocational and professional training should be brought into our qualification framework, and to enhance articulation between vocational training institutions and universities. The continuing education fund should increase in amount. We should encourage our young people to take subjects relating to science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, or STEM, and to review the relevant arrangements. Together with the business and sector and the professional sector, there should be cooperation with the education institutions to provide in-service training, and an internship training allowance should be given so as to encourage our employees to add value to their skills. And for skills or for industries suitable, we should have a professional qualification recognition mechanism so as to build a sustainable and upward mobility ladder for the professional and career development of for new generations. As for career, the government should provide more resources and also support schemes to encourage startups. There are various schemes to support startups. There is the INT Fund and also the internship program. And then there are the Youth Federation of Youth has got youth enterprise fund. However, there is a lack of publicity and not many people know about this. In 2016, a 300 million youth development fund was set up by a corporation of NGOs. This is a matching arrangement to support young startups. In her policy address, the chair, the CE announced a new program and will inject $600 million into the Youth Development Fund to support NGOs to help young people who want to start the companies in Hong Kong and GBA. BPA has already suggested to the FS that in the coming budget, a youth development fund should be turned to a young entrepreneurship fund and increase the amount to $1 billion. Mentors, tutors, and also technology support should be granted as well. As for home ownership among young people, PPA and myself have suggested to the administration time and again that we should rebuild our home ownership ladder, and we should address the home ownership aspirations of the middle class and also our young people. And we should review various successful measures adopted in the past. For instance, we can relaunch an enhanced version of a young starters scheme, and we can discuss with developers to provide small-sized and affordable housing available for rent or for sale for our young people. President, by means of these measures, we can help SMEs to develop our economy and improve livelihood. We can also promote our mobility of our young people, and that can address deep-seated conflicts in society as well. I urge members to support my amendments. Thank you.
Mr. Charles Mok, first of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Tony Chair for moving this motion on creating opportunities to assist SMEs and promoting upward mobility of young people. Creating opportunities for SMEs and promoting upward mobility of young people. How in the environment today, how can we help our young people face competition and maximize our edge? I think this also applies to the middle age, including those in the 40s, 50s to 60s. Well, nowadays, people under 60 are classified as young people. Providing enough support to SMEs and young people are important, including provision of incentives, helping them upgrade or transform themselves, developing new markets, etc. All these require visionary thinking or planning from the government's part. That way, companies with the potential can speed up the process of innovation. SMEs desperately need support in upgrading and transforming. I read an article online this morning, and the article said that to work in a small company and to take up an IT position in a small company is a nightmare. We have to really address the needs of local companies. To help these SMEs in transforming themselves, the nurturing of INT talent is very important. I've always said that Hong Kong lacks the talents for existing IT professionals who want to learn more in terms of data security, AI, big data, cloud computing, system auditing, etc. The fees, including tuition, are extremely high. A lot of professional IT courses, including remote online courses, are not covered by the CEF, and exam fees are not covered. Even for different sectors or people who do not have an IT background, they might be interested in learning coding or picking up new skills or to automate the processes in their own company. But what kind of support is given? There is none. Last year, in the policy adjusts introduced some enhancement measures, for example, increasing the limit from $10 to $20, but we have to wait till the courses that start from February. But I think this is, well, at least we don't have to wait 18 months. If the government really wants to promote continuing education, they should consider, well, for people who have applied for CEF before, the account value should receive a 10% ejection. I think injections. I think our competitors like Singapore are already doing it. That's how the government can encourage the young and middle-aged to pick up new skills. But if a new measure would have to wait so long before it's realized, I think the government is the one who needs to be transformed. From the Singapore example, we see that they have strived to promote digital training. Over the past few years, 370,000 people have received training, and 4.8% or 48% are receiving on-the-job training to enhance their edge. There is a clear objective, and the goal is that by 2023, 20,000 civil servants would have to learn digital sciences, and the government is working with 12 institutions to provide 2,500 courses for their civil servants. As for SMEs, Singapore has an enhanced training support scheme for SMEs to provide a 90% subsidy, and there are more than 1,000 courses available, and some of the courses take place at training centers, and some take place remotely at home. So there are many formats, and one-stop application is possible, but Hong Kong is lagging behind. This year, the government launched the INT talent scheme, but the needs of current INT professionals could not benefit, and there are great constraints. In terms of support to STEM education, there is a lack of mention in the policy address, and there is limited support to transforming IT talent. To maintain our competitive edge, the Hong Kong government must help or support the startups and SMEs and help them expand markets. Under the China-US trade war, the situation is even more complicated. We should step out beyond the realm of the Bay Area. I'm sure companies would make the best decision for themselves. They feel that for the mainland and Bay Area markets, they are keeping tabs on their prospects or future. Many of them have instead opted for the Asian market or even especially Southeast Asia. I think this is something the government must realize under the FTA free trade agreement signed with ASEAN countries. There is a lot to be done. Global support is lacking. We suggested Invest Hong Kong to set up INT centers for Hong Kong in places like the Silicon Valley, and we should create a favorable environment of regulation. And I suggested that the policy address should introduce INT briefings with the INT office, so that we can exchange policy views with the trade, and we should improve the current regulatory regime, and together with experts and academics, we should have a dedicated task force to study legislation on technology. That way, we can speed up the amendment of legislation and help remove barriers for the industry. In terms of our procurement policy, we can see that in the coming financial year, the government will introduce a new procurement policy. This is significant because in the past, a lot of companies, including local enterprises and SMEs, were rejected by the government. The government would not procure their products. My recommendation is that startups should be given a platform to facilitate collaboration with the government. That way, more startups and local enterprises can participate in government projects. Hopefully, the government can implement this soon. Another of our suggestions is that by next April, an innovative procurement policy will be introduced, and the government will also promote a smart government and provide a matching platform for local companies to understand the government's needs and submit product proposals accordingly. Hopefully, this can help secure more references for these companies from the government. In terms of subsidies and support, there are many funds available, including a subsidy to support the recruitment of INT talent, support for SMEs, the postdoctoral hub, INT voucher scheme, etc. Last month, I held a sharing session attended by SME representatives. They shared their experience and views. We saw there are still a number of problems, but fortunately, the INT Commission were willing to listen. So convenience is very important in terms of applications. Singapore provides a business grant portal, which is a one-stop service. After answering a few questions and completing a form, you can track the progress of the application online, and subsequently a letter would be issued. I don't know whether their work took 18 months, but in Hong Kong, there is no one-stop service or applications. Hopefully, the government can listen to the users so that their policies would better fit the needs of local enterprises and SMEs. That way, Hong Kong can enjoy a more significant role in INT. Thank you.
Dr. KK Kwok, thank you, Mr. President. First of all, I'd like to thank Mr. Tony Chair for moving this very meaningful debate. We want to help the SMEs. We want to help the young people to move upwards socially. But then if you talk about upward social mobility, I think that it was relevant in the post-war period. After the Second World War, everybody was talking about reconstruction. There were a lot of opportunities, golden opportunities. As a result, people studied, they started a business, and they were able to move up the social ladder. In today's world, if you talk about social upward mobility, young people will say that this is impossible. In Hong Kong, what the young people see is high land price policy, violation of the one country, two systems principle, and for Hong Kong ruling Hong Kong, this is no longer honored. Recently, for the Asia Pacific Institute of the CEO Hong Kong carried out an opinion poll asking the people of Hong Kong if they would like to emigrate. Over 80% of those interviewed across different age bands responded. Many have already voted with their feet, and so they could not have been interviewed. Now, one out of three would like to leave Hong Kong. If you focus on the young people, the ratio would be much higher, 50%, perhaps one out of two would want to go. Can they see any opportunities in Hong Kong? If you want to let young people have opportunities, first of all, please look at the broader picture. Find out about the attractiveness of the city so that they are willing to stay. For example, there is a clear direction for future development, and their voice is being heard and given weight by the government. And then there are policies in place to help the young people. And with their own hard work, young people can move upward socially. Is this what we are getting? Can this be done? For young people, whether they are graduates from universities or having other forms of educational attainment, in the past 10 or 20 years, for the median wage, I don't think we have seen much change. Yet, on the other hand, the property prices for residential homes are going up. There aren't too many job opportunities. Now you start talking about upward social mobility. In Hong Kong, we have the basic law. We're supposed to be promised one country, two systems, and a high degree of autonomy, people of Hong Kong governing Hong Kong. But we see and we have seen small circle elections. The voice of the young people has been suppressed. But for those who are powerful, influential, like those elected by functional constituencies, those who represent the large enterprises, yes, their voice has been heard. For SMEs, again, they have found that they're being squeezed out by the large corporations from the mainland, like GoGoVan and Foodpanda. Such have already been acquired by the mainland enterprises that have come to Hong Kong. It's difficult for you to survive in the business environment. Even if you are able to get acquired by such larger conglomerates, you just become a pawn. Now, for the original motion, it talks about the Greater Bay Area. Well, for the young people, they don't think that it is the Greater Bay Area. It is a greater area of lies. Well, for the late Deng Xiaoping, he said that he would like to replicate another 100 Hong Kong. I think this is all because he knew about the uniqueness of Hong Kong. Now we are reversing it. We are asked to go to the Greater Bay Area so that we become another mainland city. Well, I'm afraid this is going to make the late Deng Xiaoping to jump up from his coffin. Take a look at the high-ranking principal officials. They may have just one child or two children. For those who can afford it, they will send their children to overseas cities or at least to stay in Hong Kong to make a living. Lately, we have found to our surprise that Ms. Meng Mengzhou is in fact a Hong Kong resident. Of course, they won't choose to stay in the Greater Bay Area. They would rather come to Hong Kong, at least, or better still, to go to other places. So judge not what they say, but by what they have done. For the Greater Bay Area, many people have said that this is good. It is a policy from the Central People's Government, and Han Zheng is in fact chairing the leaders group. And then our CE vote returned by 777 votes is an ordinary member on that working group. Well, this is not the most outrageous thing. What is more outrageous is that for the think tank under Regina Yip, she has said that we need to take some money from our fiscal reserves so that we go to buy land in the Greater Bay Area. So you know what they are after. They want to get our reserves to the tune of $3 trillion so that our coffers will be depleted of everything, every cent. Now, for those who are smart, they come from the mainland to Hong Kong, and they will try to buy properties in Hong Kong. They are clever because they know that they don't want to have their assets remaining on the mainland. Otherwise, they will be confiscated by the government. And then for Star Riley, she has said that for the Greater Bay Area, we should set up a Hong Kong village. So we'll just become another mainlander. So it means that if you're too poor to buy your home and you can't wait for your turn to get an appropriate rental unit, you better go to the Beta A area. And then Chen Kunzhong has even suggested that we just build appropriate rental blocks on the mainland in the Greater Bay Area. So all such suggestions would have the result that Hong Kong will disappear. Now, just go to West Kowloon, go to any major housing developments. All the flats have been snatched up by the mainlanders. So this is a clear example. We are allowing the population of Hong Kong to be replaced by mainlanders. Now, for Zhongshan, Foshan, there are rich people there, and they have come to Hong Kong to buy our properties. Now, if we go to their cities to buy their properties, then they would welcome it because they would rather encash their assets and they spend the money on the properties in Hong Kong. Now, you advise our Hong Kong young people to go there to do this. I don't think this is right. You are trying to have an enclave. So you ask us to use our healthcare vouchers on the mainland. Like what Mr. WU Chi-wai has said, we don't have enough healthcare professionals, and still we are encouraging our healthcare professionals to go to the mainland to make a living. So ultimately, the end result is that Hong Kong will be hollowed out. The opportunities are not for the people of Hong Kong. Housing ladder. For many years in a row, Hong Kong is the place where the housing prices are most unaffordable. You don't spend even a cent for 21 years and still you can't buy a home. And what sort of a unit are we talking about? And we're talking about a household earning $340,000 a year. Such a household has to stop spending on any item at all for 21 years before buying a home of a value of $7.2 million. And you would only have a space of 400 square foot. Carrie Lam is asking us to buy the flats under the subsidized green farm scheme. Of course, this would only benefit the property sector. We are not going to have a share of the prosperity. Well, the property developers will join hands with the government. I don't think it is going to benefit us at all. I think the ultimate motive is to make Hong Kong disappear.
Mr. LUK Chung-hung. Thank you, President. Mr. Tony Z's motion is to create opportunities to assist SMEs and promote upward mobility of young people. That is very meaningful. Now, we are always nostalgic for the 1980s and 90s when opportunities abound in Hong Kong. It was so easy for you to move up the social ladder, in particular when there was the brain drain. It was very easy for young people to get promotion. Now, Hong Kong is a mature economy. Upward mobility opportunities have diminished, and because of globalization and free flow of capital, competition is much intense, and the laissez-faire approach that served us well in the past can no longer help young people. For this young term of government, we must address young people's concerns about education, career pursuits, and home ownership, and encourage their participation in politics, as well as public policy discussion and debate, so as to facilitate their upward mobility to resolve deep-rooted conflicts in society. It's been some time since this government started, and yet we see that there are still a lot of uncertainties, and we're not seeing the end of the tunnel. And instead of upward mobility, there is downward mobility. We have to help our young people when moving up this reverse tide. Now, I would first like to talk about education. Every year, we've only got 50,000 UGC-funded places, and the tuition fee is about 40,000 per year, and 4 years is $160,000 in tuition fees. In fact, many people have acquired the basic DSE qualifications for university degree, but because of insufficient number of places, they have to enroll in subsidized or self-financed places, which have higher tuition fees than UGC-funded places. So they have to take out loans, and that is undesirable. As soon as they graduate, and they have to repay the loan, and they have to continue with their education afterwards. And we attach too much significance to degree or university education. We have not done enough to promote vocational and skills education and academic education, and also vocational education are very different. Is there any opportunity for articulation for the two. So everyone is trying their best to do well in DSE examination, and as a result, students are under extreme pressure and they cannot give full play to the potential. And then even after they have graduated, they are heavily indebted. So their life is very tense. So they lose out even at the start of their career. And as for career pursuit, well, it's not difficult for people to get a job now, but the starting salaries are very low. We don't have enough momentum in our economy, so we still rely on the traditional industries like real estate and also financial services. So, and what is left is services industries where the technical threshold and skill threshold is low, and we lack impetus in our economic development. The government has not attached sufficient significance in the development of skills and vocational. And according to CNSD, the medium income of this group of young people is only $15,000. So our young people are doing low-paid jobs. Although the government encourages our young people to start their own businesses, but then the startup costs are very high because of high rental in Hong Kong. And it is among the startup rate in Hong Kong is the lowest in the whole of Southeast Asia. All right, home ownership. As many people have said, you have to refrain from spending or eating for 21 years before you can afford a flat. And for 9 years in a row, we are placed with the most expensive flats in the world. And we only talk about a very small-sized flat. So you have to spend 21 years of your income on your home. So you will spend half of your life repaying mortgage. So are you going to work all your life for the sake of a flat? So you won't have the luxury to talk about your ideals and your vision. There is no momentum, no incentive for people to do better, do well. So acquiring a home is now a wishful thinking, and they are entirely desperate. So you cannot afford a flat. Even if you can, you will spend your whole life repaying mortgage payments. So some young people feel that even if there are more flats in supply, they are not sure they can afford them. As a result, they lose the incentive to raise their to raise a family. However, we must help our young people. And as for a student loan, we hope that the means-tested loan scheme should only calculate in commence the calculation of interest accrued after students' graduation. We should establish a flexible repayment system, and we should allow time for them to accumulate capital for seizing opportunities. We should also strengthen vocational education, introducing a dual system in vocational education training, encourage enterprises to provide apprenticeship and trainee schemes to train talents. For instance, the construction sector, the marine sector are starting such initiatives so that we can attract young people to join these force, and we can also attract new blood for trades facing manpower shortage. And the administration has also accepted our proposal to enhance the subsidy under the continuing education fund from $10,000 to $20,000. But that is not good enough. It should be further raised to $40,000, and the scope of subsidy should also be enhanced, and we should encourage SMEs to provide paid training leave. And as for career pursuit, we should promote diversity in our industries. The government's plan is that by 2022, we can spend 1.5% of our GDP on training. But the figure in Shenzhen and South Korea also is 4%, and Shenzhen 3%. So we have a lot to catch up. We should promote development in cultural and creative industries, on-street economic activities, and sports-related activities. Industries so that there are more choice for our young people. And we should also dovetail with the global trend of industry 4.0 and omni-channel retail so as to promote support services to SMEs. And we should provide shared offices at low rent for young people who wish to start their businesses. GBA is a golden opportunity. We can set up offices in GBA cities to encourage our young people to tap into this market. And we should also provide employment subsidy. There should be more tax incentives. We'd like to see a dual track development. I hope that new industries and enterprises in GBA can also come to Hong Kong to create job opportunities so that Hong Kong can also enjoy the opportunities brought about by GBA development. We should promote various skills competition. For instance, FTU has promoted cooking competitions and hairdressing, so and so forth. We can enhance the recognition of professional skills of various trades. And we should also rebuild the home ownership ladder. So we must move up the ladder together with our young people. Thank you.
Mr. Paul Chair, thank you, President. I'd like to thank Mr. Tony Chair for proposing this motion as well as the amendments from other members. I am fully supportive. As for paragraph 6 providing a housing ladder, I would like to discuss the use of MPF as a means to housing for young people. Last year, MPF performance was very poor. The average loss per person was $22,000. A lot of young people asked about my view, and there were plenty of complaints. A lot of people complained that they had issues about housing and they still had to make contributions to the MPF. So they had a gloomy picture of Hong Kong's future and they even considered emigration. And this is one of the reasons our young people are considering moving from Hong Kong. They are yet to be housed, but they have to continue to contribute to the MPF. And thinking about retirement life decades down the road is something that they cannot imagine. Mr. Matthew Chang's cash handle was a mess, and there were millions of applicants, and yet only 1 million forms were asked, and people were asked to bring their own sheets. And Mr. Matthew Chang said that was not ideal or reasonable. I think this also applies to our MPF. A self-acquired property can become an asset come retirement, according to a study. Even without spending a penny, Hong Kong people have to save up 21 years to save enough for housing. But this is better than giving the money to the fund managers. And you often hear from the advertisements that you should not give money to the intermediaries. whether for the home ownership scheme, HOS, etc., even if you secure a property, you still have to pay the lawyer's fees and other miscellaneous costs. Why can't the government allow the public to use their accumulated MPF benefits to pay for the down payment for a property? For Lai Chui Court in Changsha Wan, and the minimum property price is $930,000, and applicants only have to pay 5% or about $47,000 before they are able to acquire a property. For a young person earning about $20,000 a month, 2 years of MPF contributions would be enough to pay for the down payment. I'd like to quote from a recent article, and it's called How to Lose with MPF. Of the 44 Hong Kong equity MPF funds last year, the 14 top funds all held the all had the tracker fund as the main constituent. So when you compare the management fees of the tracker fund and MPF, the former is 0.1%. The latter would charge 10 times more. They are charging billions of dollars of in management fees. But for the contributors, they do not benefit at all. On the 29th of November last year, when Mr. James Lau addressed my question on MPF, he said that the average balance of an MPF account was $180,000. It would not help paying for a property. For if we use the example of Lai Chui Court, for a young person making $20,000, he or she might be able to secure housing. And this is a counter argument to what the secretary said. If the average MPF balance last year was $180,000, why didn't they acquire property? They can pay as little as $47,000, unless the secretary had a crystal ball and he foresaw that we will continue to lose money in our MPF accounts, but hopefully that would not happen. Again, to quote what the chief secretary said, we should not continue to lose money in our MPF accounts. The government APIs urge people not to pay intermediaries. For intermediaries in different industries, many transactions are conducted online without an intermediary. But meanwhile, our MPF regime means that our employees keep losing money and they have to pay a lot to the intermediaries. The MPF authority has been losing money in their investment for 7 straight years. The intermediaries are losing money every year, and apparently the MPF authority does not care. So this is just unreasonable. For the $4,000 handout or the toll rationalization plan of the government, apparently all these could not be justified. But so the government should do something good by allowing accumulated MPF benefits to be used as down payment for a first property. The government can also consider using the MPF balance to support startups for young people. The government has been citing high risks, and that if they lose money, then by the time people retire, they would have nothing left. So my proposal is to allow the use of accumulated MPF benefits for home ownership. Of course, any form of investment would not have a guaranteed return. But compared with other forms of investment, property investment is relatively safe. So to allow young people to have a sense of belonging and housing, they would then be able to focus on their careers. So this is better than losing all their MPF contributions to intermediaries. In Mr. Wu Chi-wai's amendment, he talked about investment in the Bay Area, and that is in paragraph 2. And that would only encourage our young people to go elsewhere rather than stay in Hong Kong. But in item 10 of his amendment, he encouraged young people to pursue study overseas. So this is somewhat contradicting. Anything that would help the young people or help them secure a first home, well, even if they study or invest in the Bay Area, they would still come back. So we certainly have faith. Dr. KWOK's amendment is overly politicized, but for the other amendments, I think they are of reference value to the government, and they can encourage our young people to create businesses and move upwards. Thank you.
Dr. N. Cheng. Madam Deputy, in the year 2018, for those who are in business and those who are in the manufacturing sector, it was a year full of heartaches. Our motherland, China, as well as the USA, are our major trading partners, and they are now engaged in a trade dispute. And as a result, it has slowed the economic growth for Hong Kong in the second half of the year. I'm afraid China will still be the USA will still continue to regard China as a place where the US should try its best to suppress its growth. I think on different fronts, China will be constrained by the USA. We can expect the trade conflict to continue for some time to come. Some economists have even predicted that the US-China trade conflict may impact upon Hong Kong for another 20, 30 years. So for the DAB, we believe that the Hong Kong government must keep an eye on the development of the trade dispute between the USA and China constantly, and provide relief measures for the SMEs. We should also revive the former special loan guarantee scheme. We know that we have got 340,000 SMEs accounting for over 90% of our enterprises, employing 46% of the employees in the private sector. Therefore, the SMEs' performance will have a lot to do with our economic development. In fact, for our SMEs, I think they are faced with a rising business cost, and then the government has also said that the offsetting mechanism of MPF contributions will be scrapped, and then it means that their financial burden will just increase. Well, Hong Kong is an international financial center. In the face of the escalating trade dispute, we should be on the same side as our motherland, and we should engage ourselves in the new form of international cooperation. We should also expand our investments in other places. We should also rely on the opportunities of the Belt and Road Initiative. We should take the initiative to cooperate with the relevant countries, set up industrial parks in their countries so that SMEs can be given help to go out and then we can diversify our business. On the other hand, in order to facilitate the clearance of people, I think at the major boundary crossing points, there should be round-the-clock operation and the procedures should be simplified. Currently, there are many crossing points, Lok Ma Chau, as well as the Hong Kong Macau ferry pier operate around the clock. For the rest, the opening hours are limited. But then the movements of people are getting more and more frequent. And then with the Greater Bay Area development, I think more and more people will be applying between the two places. So we need to consider doing the following at Shenzhen Bay Port, for example. That is the round-the-clock operation of the immigration facilities. Madam Deputy, for the young people, they are at advantage. They have got endless vitality. We should think about the future of the young people. We should provide more opportunities to them. Now, for Hong Kong and the mainland to join hands to develop the Greater Bay Area, it means that we are opening up more space for the people of Hong Kong, the young people of Hong Kong, to develop their potential. I urge the young people to take this opportunity. During the early days, there are many opportunities, but if you don't become the early bird, if you don't go there to have a look and to look for opportunities, I'm afraid you're going to miss the opportunities. I hope the government will continue to encourage the young people to go to the mainland to have a look of the Greater Bay Area as well as other mainland places. Now, on the question of young people, I think you know that for Lan Kaiqiu, he wrote an article talking about China as a young person. And then in his writing, he said that the old would always think about the past. The young would always think about the future. When you talk about the future, there will be a lot of hopes. This means that the young people should always be hopeful. They should have a lot of dreams, a lot of aspirations. They will try to see how they can realize their dreams. It is only natural. But recently, it is indeed a fact that when we talk to the young people, many of them don't actually know what they want to do. I recently saw a movie that's about young people. Well, usually in the past, when we talked about young people, we would say that young people didn't know about sadness. Now, having seen the movie, I got the answer. In fact, young people are really sad, they are unhappy. Though in the past, we thought that young people didn't know what is unhappiness. So there's the movie called The Taste of Youth. Senior secondary students were interviewed as to what they have got planned for themselves. We also asked about their relationship with their family members. It was found that the young people today are really smart. Probably this is because of the access to the internet. They have got mobile phones and then they can make good use of the search engines. Therefore, young people are very knowledgeable. They know a lot. That makes me ask myself this question. Why is it that they are in such a state. Having seen the movie, I try to ask young people what they want to do in the future. Then they would always say, no, I don't know. I'll wait and see. Probably it's good to have my own home and then I'll get married. No, I don't know. I don't know what I will do. And then a young girl was interviewed. She was a top achiever in the school. When she was asked as to which discipline, which subject she would choose, she said she didn't know, and she even cried. So if they have no hope about the future, of course you will be unhappy, you are sad. For the DAB, a few years back, we already asked the government to emphasize life planning. The government has responded to our request. Funding has been provided, and we have also got teaching posts for life planning, career planning. Would that be adequate? We carried out a survey, and it was found that many young people, many students think that it is a good idea. However, the form that it takes may not be of great assistance to them. Therefore, for us in the DAB, we have made a number of recommendations. Say, for example, perhaps we can try to help schools to organize life planning activities. And then the Labour and Welfare Bureau and the Education Bureau can join hands to ask the successful people to talk to the young people, and perhaps the students can also go to have a taste of the workplace. Teachers should also know more about life planning education, and this should become a compulsory subject for university students at the education university. Madam Deputy, as far as Wu Chi-wai's amendment is concerned, your time is up. We have reservation. Please take your seat.
Secretary for Commerce and Economic Development. Madam Deputy, SMEs are the cornerstone of Hong Kong's economy. The government places great emphasis on promoting the development of SME and strives to create a favorable business environment for SMEs by offering sufficient support. We are keeping tabs on changes to the economy, and we would review our measures from time to time. On the China-US trade conflicts, the government has been monitoring the developments and its impacts on Hong Kong's economy while maintaining communication with the trade. The CDB and Trade and Industry Department have met the main chambers and SMEs in Hong Kong on multiple occasions to take in concerns from the trade and address their needs. Specific measures have been launched to help local companies, including SMEs, open up new markets, easing their financing burden, and enhancing protection for Hong Kong exporters affected by the US tariff measures. Moreover, the government strives to develop new growth drivers for our economy, and the Belt and Road Blueprint of our country, as well as the Bay Area developments, will bring about new opportunities for our development. The SAR government would help enterprises grasp these opportunities and better connect to the world to create more opportunities for the enterprises. Promoting I&T development is among our key policies for the current term government, and in the past 3 years, more than $100 billion were invested for different measures, including investment infrastructure, incentivizing R&D, promoting reindustrialization application of I&T, converging I&T talent. The objective is to enhance our I&T ecology to improve our competitive edge and provide more opportunities for SMEs and young people. Youth development is also among our focus. The SAR government hopes to create favorable conditions for young people to realize their dreams. The government strives to pay attention to our young people's education, career, and home ownership aspirations and encourage them to participate in politics as well as engage in public policy discussion and debate to facilitate upward mobility. In the past year, the government has implemented a number of measures and policies in this regard. Madam Deputy, since the theme of the motion debate today is far-reaching, I hope to listen to views from the trade before we offer further response. Thank you.
Mr. Martelio, Madam Deputy, SMEs and young people are important assets to Hong Kong and our economy. As said by the Secretary, SMEs are the pillars of our economy. When the economy is booming, we have 340,000 SMEs bringing job opportunities for our workforce. And they also contribute a lot to our GDP. However, when the external environment is uncertain and SMEs are always the first and hardest hit. In the past few years, we have seen a considerable development in our economy. The government has enhanced support for SMEs. However, the government tends to be conservative. For instance, from time to time, the government injects money into various schemes for supporting SMEs or extending the period of application or enhancing the subsidy ceiling, and may help them to tap into overseas markets. These measures are sympathetic to the operating difficulties faced by SMEs. However, they lack imagination, and they fail to create more opportunities for SMEs. SMEs have asked that some of the funding schemes for SMEs should be merged, and then there should be a one-stop service for the application and processing of such funds. If the administration can heed their advice and merge SME Loan Guarantee Fund and Marketing Fund, then I'm sure they will be very useful to SMEs by reducing their administrative workload. The government is trying to turn Hong Kong into a smart city, and we have a cloud infrastructure and a platform for big data analysis to support the creation or development of e-government services. The government should take this opportunity in terms of design and construction to cater for the needs of SMEs and provide more services to provide better support to them and to help them to develop new markets and to alleviate the impact brought about by the trade conflicts between the country and the U.S. IMF has for the second time in recent days, lower the economic forecast for the world in 2019, and the government should act quickly. Please don't wait until we see a spate of closures of SMEs before we take action. We must adopt a preemptive approach. And to promote upward mobility of our young people, the government should also act quickly. Young people are the future masters of our community and is a driving force for economic development. However, our young people encounter various difficulties in education and employment. The government should create an environment conducive to the growth of our young people. Although Hong Kong is affected by an uncertain global economic outlook, we can benefit from GBA. According to a survey, for young people interviewed who are willing to go to GBA for work or employment, only accounted for 20%, 50% of them said they would not move to GBA. However, 44% of the respondents agreed that GBA development would bring opportunities. The government must help young people to fully understand the development potential of GBA so that they can move out of the comfort zone in Hong Kong and set eyes on the 9+2 GBA development. For a new graduate,
Now, if in our universities, they have career support services, but if they want to seek employment in GBA, they are on their own. So we should set up more offices in the GBA cities. We should also boost the relevant office establishment. Many young people who want to set up businesses in the mainland have said that information is not that transparent in the mainland. And when they apply for assistance, they face a lot of difficulties. They want the government to play a more proactive role so that there can be a better coordination with the administrative authorities there to reduce the hurdles. The country has introduced a number of national treatment for Hong Kong people, such as the residence permit, and social security, medical services, and education for their children. The government should publicize such new measures to our young people. GBA is still at its early stage of development. More support is needed in some areas. The government should be more proactive in helping them to build up a platform for development and help them to resolve difficulties they encounter when they are developing in GBA. Whether we're talking about SMEs or young people, if they would want to seek opportunities in GBA, they should have this mentality of a win-win situation. They should not think of competing with their counterparts, and there should be a there should be division of labor, and they should complement one another in their strengths and roles so that we can have a way out for SMEs and our young people. Thank you. Mr. Chen Hak-ken.
Thank you, Madam Deputy. I want to thank Mr. Tony Z for moving this motion on creating opportunities for SMEs and promoting upward mobility for young people. The original motion contains a lot of specific measures to help SMEs and young people. For instance, reforming our procurement and tendering system and how we can help SMEs and young people to do businesses in GBA and provision of funds and also shared offices, so on and so forth. I support all these measures. Actually, in the last term of this council, I moved a motion of 4 pages in total on how to help our young people. And there were 4 things mainly in my motion: education, career pursuit, and starting their own business, and also home ownership. In fact, title of my motion might be different from this, but they are quite similar. All these issues are not new to our community. I think on various occasions and at different meetings, we've been discussing how to help our young people to resolve difficulties they encounter in education, career pursuits, startups, and home ownership. Have we made any progress? I'm sure there are some examples. And as said by the Undersecretary, the government has done a lot to help, but these are measures are really effective. Now, recently, I had a conversation with 2 young people who have just started their own businesses. And when the government helps startups, the focus is mainly at the inception stage. And when a young person wants to start his business, of course, he is lack of funds, and there are various startup funds for them to choose from, but they are mainly for innovation and technology. Well, if I want to start an IT business or creative industry, of course, I'm eligible. But there are young people out there who are not in this new economy. They are more interested in traditional industries, such as starting a coffee shop, selling a bubble milk tea,
And if they want to start a shop selling such items, can they get any financial assistance? I don't think so. We do not have any dedicated funds to help young people who are interested in traditional businesses. We cannot say that all young people are talents or experts in IT, and some of them are more interested in traditional businesses. So we should think how we can help them. One young person told me that he could not open a bank account when he wanted to start his shop. And I think many members here have encountered or mentioned such a problem. I ventured to help him to ask how a bank account can be set up. The lowest would require $70,000 to be deposited. Well, you may ask, if he doesn't even have $70,000, what business can he do? Well, the fact is, a young person may not have $60,000 or $70,000 in his bank. And most of the most extreme case, a bank asks for at least $200,000 to be deposited in the account. I don't think ordinary grassroots can have $200,000 in deposited in a bank account. And how can you expect a young person to do that? However, if the young person cannot set up a bank account, he cannot do any business. As a result, he has got $100,000 he asked another friend to chip in $100,000, and eventually they managed to open a bank account. This is one big obstacle they face. So I've just given you some examples. And there are cases where the startups have been up and running for a few years, but still struggling to survive. So what has the government done to help startups at this stage? I think their biggest difficulty lies with cash flow. If they borrow money from a bank, then the bank will ask him, what collateral do you have? And for these young people, there is some little collateral they can provide. So it's actually difficult for them to take out bank borrowing. Perhaps they can only ask from their parents. So they are not startups, they already are operating a shop, but they still face this difficulty. And of course, for a shared office space, of course, this will be more useful for those engaged in e-commerce and INT. But for young people engaged in traditional businesses, how can they share office space? Shared office space is not going to help. They need places where rent is relatively cheaper. Can we give them a hand in this regard? So when we help young people, we should not just think of innovation and technology, and don't just think of the inception stage. When they are up and running, we should give them a helping hand. So please bear in mind the difficulties faced by these two young people I happen to know. Thank you.
Kang Yiyun.
Mr. Kenneth Lau. Thank you, Madam Deputy. Currently, we have got 340,000 SMEs, accounting for 98% of our enterprises, providing 1.3 million jobs, 45% of our labor force. In other words, SMEs are crucial for our economic lifeline. Now, with the U.S.-China trade conflict, it is not easy for the SMEs to survive. the government should provide a favorable business environment for the SMEs, and we should help the SMEs to open up new markets. Now, for biotechnology, smart city, AI, fintech, they have been chosen by the government to receive more support. And then we have the Lok Ma Chau River Loop. We have enhancement of the Science Park. Innovation Technology Fund has been given more injection of funding. And I know that robotics, etc., have all been emphasized by the government. Now, $90 billion have been set aside. According to the Invest Hong Kong in the year 2018, for those startups operating from the space sharing scheme for youth, etc., as well as the incubators scheme, there were 2,600 of them, an increase of 18%. The startups have employed 9,500 people, an increase of 62%. So startups and also fintech enterprises are expanding. Well, the government has put in a lot of resources to drive the entrepreneurship of young people. And the government has also joined hands with a number of organizations, the Science Park, Cyberport, the Hong Kong Design Center, the Hong Kong Youth Federation, as well as the Labour and Welfare Bureau and the CEDB. Well, I am afraid there is a risk of overlapping of efforts and also overlapping of resources. The outcome is doubtful. We have got 570 enterprises involved in the incubation scheme. 75% of them are still in operation, but it doesn't mean that they are making a profit. We can't just talk about investment without looking at the achievements. The government hasn't come up with any useful indicators, and also the young people or the businessmen involved have not shared with us what they have learned out of it. As to why the startups have been abandoned, is it because their products are not welcomed by the consumers, or is it because of poor management, or is it owing to other reasons? Whether an enterprise succeeds or fails, the experience will still be of great reference value. It is indeed important to record the reasons so that successors can learn from their experience. Madam Deputy, many members have spoken in relation to the need to help our young people to take up the opportunities offered in the Greater Bay Area. I don't want to repeat the points made. Let me talk about the difficulties faced by the SMEs, one being cyber security. There was a survey, 300 SMEs were covered, educational institutions as well as other industries. 71% of those interviewed told us that they had an incident concerning cyber security. Either they have been hacked or attacked, and in fact some of them, that is 52% of them, told us that they weren't too sure about the cyber threats that they are facing. Recently, we have got broadband companies, airline companies, as well as travel agents whose websites have been hacked. As a result, the data of their clients have been leaked, and we have also seen banks suffering from cyber attacks. In other words, in this information age, cybersecurity is an important topic. Now, the hackers come from different countries of the world. Even for larger corporations, they find it difficult to defend themselves, not to mention the SMEs. Therefore, I'm in support of point 8 in Mr. Charles Mok's amendment. And then for the startups, I think usually they have to rely on a huge amount of personal data of their clients. Usually they will emphasize R&D instead of getting a dedicated staff member to protect their own data. Perhaps the Innovation Technology Bureau, as well as other bureaus, can help in this regard. They can provide support and provide advice in terms of cybersecurity. This will go a long way which was helping the SMEs, and we can also safeguard the privacy of many citizens. Well, the global trend is that innovation technology has already disrupted our conventions. Robotics and AI are going to prosper. And we should also make adjustments in the light of the latest developments. We have a very keen demand for IT people. Of course, there is a global competition for the right kind of talents. We have to nurture our young people. We have to encourage the people in the labor force to update their skills so that they can take up the opportunities. In fact, there was this biannual survey. The latest outcome is that for those aged between 18 and 64, the rate of participating in continuing education is 25%. Well, it is lagging behind the similar rates in South Korea, over 40%, in Singapore, over 55%. Why is it so? Is it because we've got other social problems, or we can't afford our own homes, and so we lack the motivation to enhance ourselves? This is something we need to find answers to. Young people should be provided with a quality living space. Your time is up. I support Mr. Tony Chair's motion. Please stop. Ms. Claudia Mo, helping the SMEs. Of course, I would support it. If you talk about helping the young people to move socially upwards, who would dare to oppose? But then for the motion itself, well, if you examine the motion, again, it is a promotion of the Greater Bay Area. Within brackets, we referred to a design competition for construction projects. So it seems that he doesn't want us to forget which functional constituency he comes from. So do we expect something similar from the representative of the teaching profession? No, it doesn't matter. You talk about the Greater Bay Area. There are amendments from members saying that for the Greater Bay Area, even though we're interested in the development, we should still base ourselves in Hong Kong. And we want to keep our leading place in the GBA. I'm surprised. Do you think, really think that Hong Kong can be the leader in the GBA? I think you are too naive. Whenever we talk about GBA, I have to recall what Mrs. Carrie Lam has said. She has said that the young people of Hong Kong should make good use of the huge opportunities provided by the motherland, that is to go to the mainland to develop our opportunities. We need to go north to seek opportunities. But at the same time, he has said that Hong Kong is facing a peak in the aging of our population. Is that the case? I thought someone told us that we will live until the age of 120. He said that she said that young new arrivals are young in age and they can rejuvenate our aging population. So it seems that she's trying to tell the truth, or maybe it is a Freudian slip. So is she trying to replace the population with new blood? So according to Chairman Mao, young people are like the sun, the morning sun at 7 or 8 o'clock. So is she talking about movement of people? In by 2047, what will Hong Kong be like? Now the problem is that on the one hand, we are worried about brainwashing. And then on the other hand, some people are talking about life planning. I think the former education minister will come here day in, day out to talk about life planning. What do we plan? How? And then there were remarks saying that we need to fight for the talents. We have to keep our talents. I don't agree with you. I think there was this survey of income in the year 2017 in southern China, Shenzhen can pay more or less the same like in Hong Kong. For financial services industry, they pay almost $10,000. For IT, almost $10,000. For financial services, that's even better. The pay is $15,000. But what about Hong Kong? I think in both the IT as well as the financial services sector, I think people get paid more than that level. And then for the banking industry, just visit the central. When you go to the central, of course, you will hear people speaking in English and then Putonghua. We don't hear any people speaking in Cantonese. Where have the Cantonese people gone? Maybe they have emigrated or they have gone north. Now, it is said that if young people cannot buy their own homes, they will choose to leave Hong Kong and settle elsewhere. It may be an exaggeration, but I don't dismiss it as one of the grounds to leave Hong Kong for good. The fact is that when we are given the idea of the GBA, it means that overnight we may be squeezed out. Now, I think our economic as well as our cultural features are being mainlandized. It is said that maybe we should learn from each other. In that way, our features, our characteristics will be diluted and we lose our identity. Just now, we have been given a lot of mainland jargons. Like the most important thing, being given compensation, etc. I think the mainland style has been adopted in the discourse. Now, if you can't buy your own home, you will be sort of motivated to move elsewhere. Probably it is quite true to a certain extent. If you want to help the young people to have upward mobility, what should be done? What can be done? In the year 2003, 500,000 people went out to the street to oppose the Article 23 legislation. Later on, there was a honeymoon period, like the 2008 Olympic Games and then the Sichuan earthquake. At that time, the young people were very patriotic. And we express it fully. It is a matter of blood thicker than water. Now we are in the year 2019. What has happened in the past decade? We got the umbrella movement, and then we had the anti-brainwashing campaign concerning national education. If you go to interview the undergraduates, they will tell you that they think they are Hong Kong people, they are not Chinese. Who has done this? Who caused this? If you want to help them to move upwards socially, provide them with more opportunities instead of suppressing them in all aspects. Thank you.
Mr. Chang Kim Po, thank you.